Hello, good morning, grade 11s. Today I want us to look at logarithms in computer studies, of course. When we talk of logarithms, we're talking about the method that we can use to write a computer, to prepare for the writing of a computer program. And there are obviously two types of method that we look at senior secondary school. Logarithm is just the method that we can use to write a computer program. And we can use what we call a flowchart. And we can also use what we call the pseudo code. These are the most common types of logarithms available for us. If you want to prepare a computer program, you don't straight go into the coding of the program. First, you have to prepare what a program is going to look like, how you're going to write that program, the method you are going to use. All those things are supposed to be in place. And the best, obviously, is to choose one of the two logarithms. And for today, we'll start with the flowchart. And we'll continue later on with the pseudocode. What is a flowchart? A flowchart, one, uses what we call diagrams. It uses diagrams or symbols to depict the flow of a program. So by definition, we can say that a flowchart is a graphical representation of the flow of a computer program. How the program is going to branch from one to the other, how it is going to flow, we can use what we call a flowchart to create that program. I have a screenshot on my computer here that I would want to introduce what a flowchart is. To start with, you've got what we call standard flowchart symbols there. These are the symbols that we use in order to write a computer program. First of all, when starting a program, these oval symbols are supposed to be used. The oval symbol there, one means start, the other one means end. The beginning of the program always begins with that symbol. And the end of that program, stop or end, it's the same symbol. So every time you see the oval symbol, simply means the start and the other one, the end of the program. Then, the input-output. If it's the stage where a user is supposed to enter the input, we use the parallelogram symbol. And if you need to print something out of the computer to display something, we still use the same symbol. These synonymous terms like output, and display are interchangeably used when writing any computer program, or possibly when you want to write a pseudocode or a flowchart. So every time you come to display or output, then we are going to use what we call a parallelogram there. In case you want to see something on the computer, this is the type of symbol that is acceptable when designing a flowchart. Then, apart from that, we've got what we call a process symbol. This can be used just to state what is currently happening or what we are expecting to happen at a certain stage. We use the process symbol. And we are going to understand fully the process symbol after we include what we call the working example of a flowchart. Then there is this very important symbol which we are calling the decision table. The decision table is used in a situation when we want to make a decision on one or two conditions. And for instance, I would say that you go and buy a packet of sugar if it is less than 20 kwacha. But if it's more than 20 kwacha, buy icing sugar. So I have the arrow diagram coming there to the decision table. This always goes with a question mark. You buy sugar if it is less than 20 kwacha. So buy sugar if it is less than 20 kwacha. You're going to buy if it is less than 20 kwacha. So there, it's like a question mark. Is sugar less than 20 kwacha? If yes, if it is yes, we are going to use a process symbol for buying now. Actually, this is the process symbol, then we'll say buy. And then after buying, you're going to exit and we'll stop there. So this is where we use the stop. Obviously, this is supposed to have been used when you start the program at the top. Then, if this is not true, it is false, then we are going to have another process symbol where we say buy icing sugar. There. And after you buy the icing sugar, you will come and join the stop there, so that we can terminate the program. So this is the most important diagram in flowcharts, because it enables you to branch off from a program and join the other branch depending on the outcome of that decision table. It is a true or false. If it is true, what? If it is false, then what? In this case, I used yes, then I'm supposed to use a no. Basically, those are the very basic symbols that we can use when designing an algorithm for a computer program. Then there are situations whereby, what if this program is not going to end here, but I have no space where to write the other diagram? In such a case, you use what we call a connector. This connector shows that this diagram or this flowchart has not ended yet, on that there is no space. So we are going to flip to the next page where the diagram is going to continue. When you flip to the next page, to start this diagram, to continue this diagram, also you will need to start with the same connector. So let's say this is page 3, and we've got this connector there. Connect. When I flip to the next page, to start or to continue the same flowchart, what I'm going to do, I'll continue with the same before I can add something else to this program. So I am going to put the same connector, which I had put on the previous page at the bottom. It will be on the top of the next page, to show that this is simply the continuation of the flowchart which has started previously. So like that, you will be able to write what we call a normal flowchart. So these actually are the basic symbols that we use. So we've got for the start there, then the end, it's that one. And this is the process symbol, and the input output symbol. Then we have the decision table, and decisions are used to decide which action to be taken next. And we have the flow lines. These are very important. Like I previously drew the decision table, we need to know the direction where the program is flowing to. So it makes a lot of sense to put arrows there. I normally don't give student marks if they omit this. What if the child meant that the program is going this direction, which actually will never happen in a flowchart, because this will never make sense, both going into the same decision table. So ensure you use the flow arrows properly by indicating the direction for the flow of a program. Remember, I initially said that a flowchart is used to depict the flow of a program. So, to equip ourselves very nice with this, I was asked a question by one of the Cambridge students from Recruit PTS School that, what am I going to do in terms of writing a flowchart on a question of design a flowchart of one, logging into the system, logging in Facebook. We want to log in Facebook, then two, you will need to enter user ID and password. Then three, if password and user ID they match, then you access your profile. If not, and you attempt three times for a password, three attempts, it means disable the account. So this is the problem that a child came with. We want to create a flowchart that will enable us to log in into our Facebook. Then we need to enter our user ID and we need to enter the password. And after that, if these two are successful, then we access our profile. If not, we have to try again only three times. Remember, three times. After three times, you've tried the password three times, then the account is going to be disabled. So, what are we going to do to solve a problem of this nature? Obviously, to begin with, we are going to use start. Should come down there so that it is in. Start. After starting, I'll do use the process symbol. In the process symbol, I would say enter ID and password. When you enter that, then you go to the next stage, and the next stage I will. We can design this in many ways, but in my way, I would put what I call the decision table there. The decision table is user ID and password correct. Then I will have two arrows coming out for yes or no. If it is no, I need to find out, because it says three times you have to try. After three times, the system is supposed to lock you. So I will need to use, obviously, another decision table to check how many times. Say three times already. If no, then I'll need to use a process table again there and say try again. Then I'll go back there to enter the password and the username. If yes, I'm going to use the process table again, and I'll say account disabled. Let me just create some space so that you, we can have a normal view. Right, so we have acquired enough space now. So we were here. We go back there, we're saying that the ID and user password correct. If no, you have to check the number of attempts, if there are three attempts already. Are they three? If no, then we need to try again. Then enter the user password again for the second time. The second time again, you check if the user ID is and password they match. If no, then you try again for the third time. Now, for the third time, if this attempt says that the third attempt says that it's wrong, they are not correct, then you say yes, which means now your account is going to be blocked, account disabled. Disabled, and you stop. There is nothing more you can do because your account has been disabled. But when you enter the user ID and the password, and they are both correct, so here it was no, then here it will be yes. If it is yes, we are going to display profile. So we are going to use what we are calling the input output, the parallelogram, obviously. Then display profile so that you can actually see your timeline there. And now, since you are so very happy you've logged in, and the program is supposed to terminate like that. So this is one of the ways we can write the program using a flowchart. This is an algorithm, and when you run this on a computer, it cannot run. It's just a platform or the blueprint of how the program is going to be created when you are designing your program. I hope that was so very helpful. And remember, this video will be on YouTube. You search for Matthew's Warrior, and you'll be able to see this video if you have questions. Next time, we'll still continue with flowchart. We'll try to look at some other problems that come with flowchart. Goodbye for now, and see you next time.